two-dimensional quantum field theory. So quantum field theory, in general, can be described by a theory on the world line. So even if you're in 3 plus 1 dimensions, computing a vacuum polarization diagram, there's a useful method that was introduced by Feynman and Schwinger already, an internal description of 0 plus 1 dimensions with these vertices represented by vertex operators that just act in this 0 plus 1 dimensional space. String theory can be described by a theory on the world sheet in 1 plus 1 dimensions. So this circle is like this surface of this torus here, surface of a donut. But just like here, there are vertex operators representing these vertices here. So now this is a theory internal to this 1 plus 1 dimensional world, and that's the world sheet. Later we'll use even more special 1 plus 1 dimensional theories that have a conformal symmetry. But here in this video, just like in Polchinski's book, I will focus on general 2-dimensional quantum field theories. They're not necessarily conformal. In 2 dimensions, it's useful to think about complex coordinates. So considering wave physics, a wave that goes left or right, this is distance plus minus velocity times time. So this is a left or right moving wave. On the world sheet, we have coordinates sigma 1 and sigma 0 that we used to call sigma and tau. And similarly, a left or right moving wave is on the world sheet described like this. But now we rotate with your Wick rotation with the imaginary unit I to Euclidean time sigma 2. With this coordinate, we can introduce complex z, that is this complex combination, and z bar, which is this complex combination, and define derivatives with respect to these complex variables. This is standard in complex analysis. If you do it like this, with a 1/2 and the sign minus here corresponding to this plus here, then you get that del z of z is 1/2 times this, and there's a cancellation, minus I times I is plus, so you get a 1. So you see that del z of z behaves just like a real derivative of x would have on x, and del z bar of z by cancellation is 0. So now we can forget about the origin and just think of these complex variables where del z of z is 1, like you would expect it, and del z bar of z is 0. Let's consider the Polyakov action. So of course this is a very special quantum field theory in 2 dimensions. It's free. It consists of mu runs from 0 to capital D minus 1. So you have capital D, the number of dimensions, massless scalars on the world sheet denoted by z. And here's the normalization we had from a previous video. So we vary the Polyakov action with respect to x. You get the equation of motion that the Laplacian, meaning del bar of x, this is short for del z, del bar z of x, is 0. So that's our classical equation of motion. Now what is the quantum equation of motion? This trick is used in Polchinski. We write a total derivative in the functional integral. So we'll talk a little bit more about this later, but you should have seen functional integrals in your quantum field theory course. So integral dx of d dx, this is equal to 0 because it's a total derivative on this parenthesis. Now if we act with this, if we hit the s, we're going to generate an equation of motion. But if the derivative hits the x, then only if z is equal to z prime do we get a delta function. Otherwise, nothing. But if this is to be equal to 0, it means that in general, we can think of this as expectation values. This is the expectation value computed using this functional integral formalism. And so effectively, if there are no other operators close to these, this gives us an operator equation of motion. This is called the Schwinger-Dyson equation in quantum field theory. This is not special to 2 dimensions. We can write this kind of equation in 4 dimensions, for example. You might be more familiar in the operator formalism. There you get the delta function from a derivative acting on the time ordering t. There's a nice explanation of this in Polchinski's Appendix A. But here we're thinking about this in terms of functional integrals, where these are functions and the ordering only appears if you slice it up, as he describes here. Now you can notice something. If you find a Boson-Green's function that satisfies this equation, you can untake the derivative here, the double derivative here, and write it like this. So you can now have the derivative outside, and this plus this quantity, which turns out to explicitly be this, the Laplacian-Green's function in 2 dimensions is a log. So that means that this combination as a whole satisfies the classical equation of motion. This motivates introducing a symbol for it. So x normal ordered, what we show with these double dots, satisfies the classical equation of motion and not the quantum equation of motion that had the delta function. Conversely, we can take the original product of operators xx and write it in terms of xx normal ordered, except for this contraction. Why don't you talk so much about this in quantum field theory? It doesn't help that much because you have additional singularities from interaction vertices. In a free theory, like in the Polyakov action, this is essentially all we need to do. It makes it clear, I think, if you have a toy example, which we have in this paper. So if you take just a harmonic oscillator in quantum mechanics with this commutation relation, a dagger commutation, which means a dagger minus a dagger a equals to 1. They form this combination, which is a useful operator in quantum mechanics. Another operator, by the way, is interesting, is the number operator. This counts how many creation operators is sitting in this state n. If you form a power of q, you can actually write it out explicitly. And you can rearrange this term using the commutator into this term plus 1. So This is called normal order. So normal ordering in quantum mechanics means move all annihilation operators to the right in your expression using the commutation relation. So we can keep going and normal order different powers of q, and we get some structure here. This cannot be inverted, just recursively we can write like this. This is a Hermite polynomial. This is usually not that important. Some mathematical physicists use this definition. In fact, Polchinski's derivative formula has the same combinatorics as what we're doing here. It's slightly more complicated because in quantum field theory, the commutator is not just one, but it depends on the Green's function. Now, having normal ordering, we can form a composite operator. What I mean by that? Use the same equation we had before for xx, but now you differentiate it holomorphically. You get a similar equation to what we had before. We have already subtracted the singularity we had originally, so we can consider taking z to zero here. Then we get a composite operator at zero. And there was a singularity, so we have isolated it here. This contains 1 over z squared. This is a general phenomenon. We can also do this with boundaries. If we get the disk from your identification of the plane under z prime is z bar, by plane, by the way, some say sphere, by disk, I mean the upper half plane, then you can think of this as the method of images from electrostatics in physics. Originally, this is just a general strategy for solving differential equations. You can introduce an image charge to simulate a boundary condition. So with boundaries, we would need to include also not just this going to that, but also an image operator at the conjugate point. And later, we'll do a doubling trick to actually write this in terms of an extended field on the whole domain. Back to the complex plane. If you have one operator coming together with two that are already together, in the sense we said before, then you have to do this additional step that you normal order this with this and this with that. So you have to subtract two of these terms. Now you have this whole thing normal ordered. And this general concept is called the operator product expansion, which is much more general than the simple thing I've said here. But just to give a concrete idea, because to many people this is very abstract when you first see it. If I have an operator at point z1 and some other at z2, I can expand them in a sum, possibly infinite, of an operator, a single operator at z2, with some coefficients that depend on the distance between 1 and 2. z1, 2 is z1 minus z2. An important point is whether this is associative, and there's more about this later. Operator product expansion is not special to conformal field theory. It is of interest in quantum field theory in general. For example, in Schwarz's quantum field theory book, he has a very nice explanation of the OP in going from the standard model to the older Fermi theory. Meaning, if you have exchange between fermions of a, let's say, a W boson with mass m, the propagator is non-local, meaning you couldn't really think of this as an operator in your Lagrangian. If you expand it for low enough energy, you get a local effective vertex, meaning the expansion of this is that. And these operators, like this box here, can be included in a local Lagrangian. So this is the connection between the OP and writing a local Lagrangian effective field theory. But back to two dimensions, we want to compute a generating function of correlators. We want to compute an expectation value of products or functions of x's, where x's are a quantum field. To do so, we insert sources j, and we compute this generalized expectation value, which will then be our generating function z of j. So differentiating this z of j, we get correlators. Explicitly, this is the functional integral over the free action, which I've slightly rearranged here. So I get a minus sign, I put the normalization here. And this is done in Polchinski chapter 6.2, so it comes a little later. I emphasize that this is a generic calculation in quantum field theory. It's also discussed in a lot of the textbooks, and I recommend Ryder's textbook, quantum field theory. Now to do this, it's essentially a Sturm-Liouville problem. We expand the x field as a function of the worksheet into eigenfunctions x of the Laplacian, which is just del del bar here. And we get some constant x's as coefficients. But these things themselves are some functions that satisfy this. We don't need to be explicit right now. We will give some example later in terms of powers or plane wave. When doing this, we can actually perform these functional integrals. They become ordinary integrals over the coefficients here. We get a contribution from the free field, and then we get this source term as we put in. This ji here is defined like this. You project the j source onto the eigenfunctions x. Once you've done this, you can complete the square, do this integral. You see that this free part gives you a functional determinant that I call c tilde, and then the rest gives you this perfect square. Now this thing here can be re-expressed again in terms of the Green's function. An overall delta function will give us momentum conservation. We have a functional determinant, we have some constants, and then we have this object here, where g is our Green's function. As in Sturm-Liouville theory, the Green's function can be expanded in eigenfunctions. We exclude the zero mode here, but otherwise we see that having this eigenfunctions lets us invert the Laplacian on these eigenfunctions. On the plane, the Green's function is a logarithm z squared, so we can explicitly compute these things, find our correlators from a generating function z. At tree level, this normalization constant, c, will be constant. Its infinite needs to be regulated, but it will not be so important. By unitarity, it will be completely fixed. At one loop, the torus amplitude, the normalization, this functional determinant, does depend on a parameter that we're interested in, the complex structure tau, so we will need to compute this functional determinant, and it will be interesting in and of itself. And of course, all this can also be done in the operator formalism. You should have already seen it there, hopefully, but for now, we're satisfied with doing it with a functional integral.